Hello, hi everyone. Good evening, and I thank you everyone for joining us for our RF Junior MBA Virtual Coach Clinic online. And we have one of the coaches, Ben Sullivan from Houston Rockets, and is going to take care of the entire session for now. Just to give a bit of introduction of the coach, and he's got a long list of introduction. I just don't want to miss out. I'm just going to read out a little bit. So just to give an introduction. So Ben was born in Boston, Massachusetts. His high school was in Lake Oswego, and he did his college in Cal State Northridge and in Portland. And he started his coaching career in 2011-2012 as a college assistant in Lewis and Clark, as a college basketball assistant coach. And then later in 2014, he joined as coach for the Atlanta Hawks. And then from 2018 to 2021, he joined the Milwaukee Bucks, and that's where he got the ring, the first championship ring that he had got with the Milwaukee Bucks. I see the smile right there, Ben. And then from 2021 to 2022, he was the assistant coach for the Boston Celtics team. And then currently he's with the Houston Rockets. Now, Ben has got a package of a profile that is there. It's going to be a lot of learning from the coach that we're going to have in today's session. I really appreciate each and every coach. If you could mute yourself, if you have any questions, please feel free to put your questions on your chat box. We'll get back to you towards the end of the session. Now, before we start the session, I know I've got a lot of familiar faces. I have one of my coach join the session as well when I was a school kid. He's joined the session as well. Hi, sir. Good evening. Thank you for joining us. Please do let us know, text us, where you're from, which part of the country that you're from. That'll be helping us, to see, how many people have joined here for today's session. Now, before we start, I pass on to the session. I would like to thank to our partner, Reliance Foundation, for helping us to conduct these sessions virtually and on ground as well for the development of the coaches. Ethan, can we just play that short video of the Reliance Foundation, please? Thank you, Ethan. Now, as you've seen the video, right? So we've been associated with the Reliance Foundation since 2013. This is our 10th year. During this 10 years, we've been able to reach to 11 million youths, and we've been able to do the sessions for the coaches and PE teachers, 13,000 plus teachers that we are able to share knowledge with them to develop the grassroots level of the program here. Now, before I pass on the session to Coach Ben, I would really appreciate for all the coaches, like, you know, if you could turn on the video, we can, like, you know, see some happy smiling faces in your, I know most of the coaches you have turned on your videos. It would be great to see some familiar faces. I'd really appreciate it if you can. That'll be awesome. Great. Thank you so much, coaches. I really appreciate it. Coach Ben, it's all yours now. Thank you so much for joining us for today.
All right. Well, thank you very much for having me. Hi, everybody. Thank you for joining. Sorry about the technical difficulties and the delay, but hopefully we'll cover some stuff that will be helpful and beneficial for your guys' future and development and all the players that you're able to reach out through. Like, I just can't imagine how impactful coaching is, you know, and all the coaches that have helped me along the way and all the coaching that you guys do and all the players that you guys interact with. And it's just so, so important for our youth and the growth of the game and their development and your development and my development and, you know, as we all continue to grow. So it's definitely an exciting time. And, you know, if there's any questions or anything at all, please don't hesitate. There's no such thing as a bad question. If you're curious about anything, please throw it out there and, you know, we'll try to get to as many as we can. All right, so we're not just gonna stare at my face for this entire time. So I got prepared a video. The topic that we're gonna be covering is actually shooting. It's really specific. So we're gonna cover shooting and some shooting philosophy and some things to look for when you're teaching shooting and some thoughts. And yeah, we'll just jump right into it. So I'm gonna share my screen. So as he mentioned, my name is Ben Sullivan. I'm with the Houston Rockets. My coaching career actually started with sixth grade boys. So that would be about 10 years old. And then I went onwards and upwards and, you know, through a lot of luck and a lot of breaks, I was able to just kind of keep going to college and then to the NBA. I started in the video room in San Antonio. Then I went to the Atlanta Hawks, then with the Milwaukee Bucks, and then with the Boston Celtics. And this will be my first year with the Houston Rockets. So, talking about shooting, all right, so if you're gonna teach shooting to a person, the number one thing that you have to keep in mind is you wanna connect with the person, you wanna build a relationship with this person, all right? You gotta figure out what drives them. You know, do they wanna be successful? How hard are they going to work? And are they capable of getting uncomfortable? So if you want someone to improve at shooting, and you're gonna try and be their guide and try to take them from where they're at and take them to a higher level, one of the first things that I look for is, are they capable of being uncomfortable? Because if they're shooting a certain way and you're going to be the person that changes that, like, they're going to have to get uncomfortable. Their shot's going to change. It's going to feel different. It's going to feel weird. They're not going to like it at first. And if they are resistant to that, it's going to be really hard to change and grow and get better from that. All right. And then the next thing you do is you want to evaluate their shooting psyche. So, like, what is their relationship with their shot? You know, when you watch a player, are they willing to shoot the open shot? Do they try and create space off the dribble and take a shot? Do they constantly drive it? Do they only shoot layups or little short shots, or they only shoot threes? You know, what is their confidence? What is their shot mentality? So, for example, like, take an NBA player, Steph Curry, when he goes in the game, he's looking to shoot jump shots over and over and over again, right? Like, that's his mentality when he goes into a game. Or you take a player like Giannis, you know, he drives the ball, he gets to the basket, he's constantly attacking the rim, that kind of thing. And like, what are these players' games? What are they trying to do? And you can take that for any player at any age and kind of evaluate them and figure out how do they approach the game? How do they try to get after it? So, after you've done those things, you connect with the person, you figure out what they're trying to do, you evaluate where they're at with their shot, and then you want to look at their shot construction. So I try to look at three things that you want a shot to be. You want it to be simple, first of all. You want to create a shot that is repeatable, and you want to create a shot that is on balance every time they take it. So a simple shot is one that is fluid, great power transfer, they're able to create it and get it off with no issues. It looks easy, it looks fluid. And then you want it to be repeatable. Can they do that same action over and over again? Whether or not they shoot a 3-point catch and shoot shot, they shoot a pull-up jump shot, they shoot a free throw, they shoot a turnaround shot in the post. Like, their jump shot should look the same with every shot that they take. And then, are they able to get on balance in each of those shots? Okay, so balance is super, super important and it's underrated. And we'll get into that more. And then lastly, this is a little bit more technical, but looking at the biomechanics of people. So basketball players now come in all shapes and sizes. It's becoming more and more positionless, more and more body types are doing different kinds of things. You might have your center that shoots only threes and your guard that attacks the rim or whatever. So just looking at their, what is their body capable of? Like how long are their arms, their hand size? How are they able to grip the ball? Does their elbow lock out? Can they snap their wrist? How do they hold the ball? And so you just have to look at all those different types of things. And, each shot, I believe, is unique to each person, finding the best shot that is made for their body that they're comfortable with. And it might not be completely obvious right away, but through evaluation and watching them, you can kind of start to understand like, okay, this person is really comfortable when they shoot it like this. So we go to here is Curry, one of the best shooters in the history of the game. His shot looks like this. Here's Lillard, one of the most dynamic shooters in the game. And his shot's a little bit different. As you can see here, he has one of the most unique things. Can you guys see this mouse right here? Is that visible?
Yeah.
His hand actually comes off the ball. His finger pads come off the ball. And then when he snaps it, he puts them back on and fires through. So his shot is different. And then you got one of the best to ever do it. Jordan. Great elevation, high release point. So you'll see his release point is above his head by a fair amount. This helps make him taller. It helps him to get a shot off over defenders. It makes him tougher to guard. And his shot looks different, but it's still very effective. Able to get it off here over a contest. And then you got Dirk Nowitzki. 7 feet tall, one of the best shooters in the history of the game. His shot, if you look, his shot is right here, right at his head. And then the nearest contest, it's not even close, right? By the time he releases, because he shoots these fadeaways, by the time he goes into his shot, the contest on his shot is all the way down here. Still not able to get to it. Because the way his shot was structured based on his body type. Okay. So then we get into the evaluation period. All right. So you want to determine where they're at currently. How comfortable are they shooting a basketball? How comfortable are they when they play and shoot versus defense? Do they take the open shot? Are they hesitant at all? You just kind of evaluate where they're at. And then from that, you create a plan and you move forward, which leads to the development phase. So I always like to build from the inside out, starting close to the basket and then continue to progress and work your way out. So free throws eventually will become your home base. It's a great check-in place. Like you can just watch a free throw to see how comfortable somebody is. And also a free throw is an important part of the game for all players. And I usually start with one-handed shooting because it's a great tool to reveal a lot of different things. How do they hold the ball? Does their elbow lock out when they shoot? Do they snap their wrist? How do their fingers move when they shoot the ball? And it just tells you a lot of different things. So if you give a player a ball and say, all right, shoot it with one hand, if they're unable to do so, that tells you something. That tells you that their guide hand might be super involved in their shot, right? So you then go and progress to the shadow drill, and then you add the guide hand, and you want to allow the guide hand placement to be natural. It's really important with the guide hand that it's not in the way, it's not inhibiting the shot at all. It's allowing the ball to get from the ground or from the catch up to their set point so that they can release. All right. And so here's a player doing the one-handed shooting, and I call this 1-1-1. So they're going to shoot a one-handed shot a shadow shot, and then a shot with the guide hand on. So if you watch here, he shoots one-handed shot, and then his guide hand right here will be shadowing his shot. So it's next to the ball, but it's not actually touching. It's just right next to it. So it shadows it. So the hand never touches the ball. And if he's able to do this, what you're doing here is mimicking a shot, because shooting is a one-handed motion. The guide hand should not be participating in the shot. It doesn't add power. It doesn't add accuracy. It only allows you to get from the ground, from your dribble, from your move, up to a shooting point. So here he shadows it. And then the last shot, his hand is touching the ball, but barely. Okay. And then you cycle from those three, and you can do make 10 in five spots or make five in five spots, and you vary your distance. But the goal on that is that his shooting arm should feel the same, look the same, do the same thing on all three of those shots. And here's a similar drill from the front. You can see he's shadowing. His guide hand never touches. And now his guide hand is lightly placed on there, and he shoots it again. All right, and so I'll just rewind that so you guys can see both of these things in real time. So you just watch it. So this would be a one-handed shooting drill. This would be the shadow drill. And then this would be his guide hand slightly placed on it. Shadow. Guide hand slightly on it. And then he goes back to shadow, so on and so forth. All right. So that's a drill that I like to do with a lot of shooters, to just kind of touch base on where they're at with their elbow lock, their guide hand, and then we'll get into balance after that. All right. So these are some shooting keys. These are not all of the keys. These are some of the main ones. And with each shooter and each different type of player and type of shot, Like we touched on before, all the different shooters, all the great shooters we've had in our league, from Ray Allen to Reggie Miller to Dirk Nowitzki to Steve Nash to Mark Price to Michael Jordan to Kobe Bryant, all these elite level shooters, all their shots are a little bit different, but they all have key elements. And these are three of the key elements that we'll hone in on today. And the first one is elbow lock and wrist snap. The second one is guide hand, and then the third one is balance. So we'll just look at some examples of these. First one we'll look at is elbow lock and wrist snap. So here's Curry getting organized for a pull-up three. And then you can see at this point that elbow locks out and that wrist snaps. So try to highlight this. This elbow here is locked completely out. That's what you're looking for, this elbow to be locked. So when you're looking at a young shooter, can their elbow lock all the way out? Not everybody's can. And I've worked with guys that maybe their elbow doesn't lock out completely, but you want to be able to get to that end range motion. And then the next part is this wrist snap. Does the wrist snap and their fingers go down? That allows the ball to get rotation and accuracy towards the target, okay? Same thing with Lillard here, getting organized for this little fadeaway. You can see the same elements. So elbow locked out completely, and then the wrist snaps, fingers pointing down. All right, lots of this rotation of the ball. It spins as it goes towards its target, creating power and accuracy. Here's Jordan. Getting organized for a pull-up, higher release point, more elevation, more of a jump shooter. But you can see at the release point, his elbow locks completely out, and then his fingers go down, which creates that spin, that rotation, power and accuracy towards the target. Nowitzki, here's a clip from him in the finals. Even with a little contest, he gets a piece of the ball. He gets organized for his little controlled fadeaway. He releases away from the contest and at the point of release, see this elbow area right here? Elbow is locked out, fingers pointing down. That creates power and accuracy towards his target. And it's able to create a consistent shot. Okay. Now we'll move on to the guide hand, another element. And this is one of the trickier areas of shooting is where is the guide hand placed? What is it doing? How much is it involved? And so looking at the guide hand in each of these guys' shots. All right. So here's Curry getting organized, and then watch his guide hand right here. It's on the side. Fingers are pointed up. And then when he goes to shoot, his guide hand might move slightly forward. So if we go back and watch that through the motion, it moves a little bit forward, but I've heard Curry talk about this in interviews. He talks about thinking of his guide hand as being like a dead arm. Once he gets up to this shooting point, the shooting hand takes over, his guide hand's just relaxed. It's along for the ride so that his shooting arm can take over. Here's Lillard, a little bit different. So at this point, his guide hand is a little bit in front of the ball. Like these fingers right here are a little bit in front. But as you watch in slow motion, he gets it a little bit out of the way. And now when he goes to shoot, it's all one-handed. His guide hand's not participating. It's not turning. His thumb's not moving. It's all his shooting arm. Here's Jordan. Watch his guide hand. So his is also, I would say a little bit in front, but as you watch, as he gets ready to shoot, he moves it, gets it out of the way, and now his shooting arm takes over and his guide hand is not doing anything to get the ball towards the basket. So that's one of the first red flags you can see is if anyone's guide hand is helping them get the ball to the basket, that is just going to lead to inconsistencies over time. You're never going to be able to get to be as consistent as you could be if you don't have your guide hand participating. Your guide hand job, once again, is just to get the ball up to your shooting point to allow your shooting arm to take over. It's a great view of Nowitzki from behind. So as we see, he gets up to release. His guide hand is on the side, right here. Hand, fingers on the side. And as he goes to shoot, now his guide hand is off the ball. There's space in between these two. His shooting arm takes over. And now it's just elbow lock, wrist snap towards the target, completely locked out, fingers down as he lets it go. So that is another huge, huge key. And then lastly, for our keys, we'll get into the balance of everything. And it's key when you look at their legs. Are they capable of getting on balance on the move? Are they capable of getting on balance when they're stationary and somebody drives and kicks it to them? Are they capable of getting on balance when they're dribbling and creating a shot? So balance is a big key. So if you just watch from the waist down and watch their feet, he takes a step back, he gets low, his legs are loaded. So you want to watch everything from here down, okay? His legs get loaded. And he uses all those big muscles, quads, glutes, hamstrings to get loaded to create the power necessary to shoot the shot. And so at this point, he releases the ball. He's completely on balance. You could almost draw like a door around him and he could fit in a door frame. Like he's perfectly on balance when he shoots. And that's one of the more underestimated things of all the great shooters. If you watch them shoot, they are constantly fighting to be on balance. And there are all different types of drills you can do, make guys run and stop and jump stop and 1-2 step and or 2-foot hop into their shot and just constantly challenge them to get on balance when they're moving quickly so that they can shoot a shot. Here's Lillard, dribble move, stops on a dime. and then elevates. And now when he shoots, he's on balance. So you go right here, watch everything below his waist, stops, watch his legs fire. Boom, he plants both feet at the same time, gets great balance, elevation. Now when he shoots, he's got that perfect, perfect balance. Where right here, he's straight up and down. Because with shooting, you want to eliminate variables. You want to eliminate the guide hand being involved. You want to eliminate drifting to the left or right or back or forward. The only time you really work on any sort of off balance is if you're working on like a controlled fadeaway jump shot from the post or pull up or something like that. Something that Nowitzki, Durant, Bryant, Jordan, all these guys kind of master over time. They work on like a controlled fadeaway shot. The rest of the time, and for most players, you shouldn't be shooting a shot where you have to be off balance to get it off. Here's Jordan, one of the most elite athletes. And you'll see when these guys go on the move, their feet are really wide. A lot of times they're wider than their shoulders. Okay, so wider feet outside the shoulders allows for more balance. So he's able to get on balance, elevate for this controlled shot. You can see his guide hand right here, a little bit in front, but he's able to move it out of the way. And now he follows through with just the shooting arm. And he's able to elevate and knock these down. And then here's Nowitzki. He's going to shoot one of those controlled fadeaway shots. So he works on this constantly. Slight lean back. And for him, this is totally on balance, totally under control. It creates that separation so that he's able to get it off over contests. And so you have to evaluate, you know, what type of player are you working with? Do you want to work on controlled fadeaway shots? I would argue most of the time, most players shouldn't be working on those shots, but it just depends. But the first key will be being able to shoot on balance before you get to that. So the order of shooting progression. So this is how you kind of advance. So you start with that one-handed shooting drill and you slowly get to the point where that's easy for them. You get to the point where they can add their guide hand. And then after that, once they're comfortable shooting those shots close in, you add distance. So you slowly work your way out towards the three-point line, even getting to the three-point line, and you slowly increase it you want to make sure they're comfortable. And if you notice any lapse in technique, you go back. So as you increase distance, if it looks like there's a struggle, the shot starts to look different, they're doing something different, they're not able to get their balance, they're not able to use their legs, they add their guide hand, they stop snapping their wrist or locking their elbow, you go back. All right. And once you're able to shoot from a standstill, that's when you add movement. So maybe you start above the corner and we call it drift. You drift down the corner, or you slide down to the corner, or you move from the corner up to the wing, or you run from half court to the 3-point line. You just start adding movement. And then once again, if there's any lapse in technique, you go back. And same thing with dribble. You add dribble moves, pump fake, one dribble, directions, left, right, straight on, and so on and so forth. And then you get into repetition. So once a person has the technique down, you can start to add different types of workout sessions. So once a person has technique and they just need to quote unquote rep it out, you can have a longer workout. You say, hey, today we're not adding any new technique. We're not addressing technique. If there's something that I see that you're not doing right, I'll remind you. But I just want you to focus on repetition and we're just gonna get a lot of different shots up. And then some days it might be a technique day, like, hey, I've noticed you do this, your guide hands moved, your set point is too low, you're not locking your elbow out when you shoot. And you know, you address those different technique days. And through reading different types of sports, looking at golf swings, baseball swings, a baseball pitch, the way a quarterback throws a ball, or you know, music, the way an instrument is learned, and like, just I've really tried to study different sports and different things and try to understand how people learn better. And a lot of the stuff that I've come across has kind of pointed out that you don't have to do stuff for 6 hours to learn it. When you're learning a new muscle memory, a lot of times the human brain can only handle two or three new things in a day. So you try to address those two or three things that day, 20 or 30 minutes, these shorter sessions, and it's a lot of times more beneficial and more effective if you can get in the gym with somebody 4 or 5 times a week for 30 minutes at a time addressing their shooting than it is to say, hey, let's go shoot for 3 hours today and do that every day. They get tired, they get fatigued, bad habits can form. And so if you find a player that you're working with and they want to get better and you're like, all right, we're going to work at this, you work 20 or 30 minutes dedicated, focused work on these things and just hit that multiple times throughout the week, 4 or 5 times in a week, and then allow them some rest to recover. Because with new muscle memory, the way your body works is if you learn a new muscle skill, a new motor skill in a day, the way it's written into your body is when you go to sleep that night. So sleep is super important. So you learn a new skill, like say today somebody learned something new, when you go to sleep tonight, your body is writing that in, your brain is writing that muscle memory into your body as code, so that, okay, this is how we do this now. And then you wake up the next day, you work on it again, you rinse and repeat, so on and so forth. And that is how that is built over time. And so the last part here is the shooting psyche during the development phase. And this can be tricky because when you're working with a guy and either redoing their shot, slightly altering their shot, trying to improve their shot, you have to evaluate. So, you know, what is their relationship with their shot during this development phase? Do they seem discouraged? Are they confident? Are they happy? Do they like it? Do they not like it? Are they upset? And, you know, you're evaluating their confidence, their shot mentality, their relationship with their shot. And this is one of those things that I tell guys, is like, this is a very personal relationship between you and shooting a basketball. And so, you know, I tell them all the time, like, you're the only person that's there for 100% of your shots. Like, you're going to be there every time you shoot a ball. I'm not always going to be there. So, like, you have to understand what we're trying to do, what you're trying to do, what it feels like, what we're trying to accomplish. And so it's really a two-way street in that we're kind of having a constant dialogue of where they're at mentally, where they're at physically, how it feels, how confident they are. And, you know, that's where that relationship part that we started off in the beginning talking about is super important, because if you don't build the relationship, then they may hold something back from you. They may not like something that you're doing and they'll just be like, ah, I don't like this. And they might not ever tell you. I'd rather have a guy tell me, I don't like this part, this feels uncomfortable, I don't know if this is going to work, you know, and then we can have that dialogue and I can work on maybe a different approach to getting the same thing. So once you do all those things and you work and improve, that's when you get to this level. Here they are in the playoffs. This is when you have ultimate confidence. That's when you can do it quickly, on the move, like this, sprinting full speed during the playoffs, pick and pop versus a contest. One of the biggest shots of his career, one of the biggest moments, a playoff game winner. You're able to step in and shoot with confidence in the biggest moments. And here's Jordan, finals, game winner. He's able to get organized and release. And you're able to do it in the biggest moments with no hesitation and supreme confidence because you've been able to work on all those different elements. And you're able to just feel confident when you go play and shoot and knock it down. And that's really it, guys. That's all I've got for you. So if there's any questions or anything you guys want to talk about, I'm here to get after it. Thank you, everyone.
Hey, Coach Ben, thank you so much, really so much for that, like, you know, deep dive knowledge about getting into the shooting techniques in detail. Like, there's so much to, like, you know, to process it, like, you know, and then, like, you know, to debrief it, like, you know, it's so interesting. Thank you so much for sharing your knowledge on this. I would really appreciate if you have any questions, please raise your hand. You can ask your questions directly, or if you have any questions, you can feel free to put it on the chat. I think we have Coach Charvi. Hi, Coach. Yeah. Please go ahead and ask a question. Okay, moving on. Hi.
Hi. Actually, I wasn't able to unmute myself. So, yeah. Hi, Coach.
Hi, how you doing?
I'm doing good. So, Coach, as being a coach of kids under 18, I have a doubt. Like, sometimes there are kids who come to us for the first time and they are already playing basketball. And when they shoot, they're quite accurate. Like, out of 10, I would say 70% of the shots go in, but their shooting action is not fine. Like the support hand and the main shooting hand, they are placed wrong. So should we correct them or should we let them, shoot the way they are already doing since long?
This is a great question. And this is something that we have to do at the NBA level, that to do at the college level, you have to do at the young level. I think this is an excellent question. That's part of the evaluation. So when you're evaluating a player, you're evaluating, how they're able to play. So when you watch them shoot, it might not be technically exactly what you're looking for, but if they're able to play and they're able to shoot it against defense and someone contests it and gets a hand up and it doesn't bother them and they like their shot, they're confident in their shot and their shot goes in, you wouldn't want to change that if they're able to do that at that level. Now, if they are able to do it just in practice with a lot of time and no defense and they're able to make it and then they go in the game and they're not able to do it when it counts, which is during competition, then that's something that you might want to look at. But if they do it in competition and they're able to make it and they get it off against defense, then no, I would not change it. And that's part of the evaluation phase, which you first get into of like, is there anything I even need to do with this player? And the answer might be no, they're fine. And I think that's a great question.
Coach Harvey, that answers your question. All right, next up we have Sanjay Singh Sengar. Please, coach, please unmute yourself. You can ask your question.
Coach, hello. Sir, how to manipulate the shooting action during the game period because of a fatigue level and the stress level of the player?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question?
So actually, how to manipulate the shooting action because of the fatigue level and the stress level of a player?
Okay, so let me rephrase that question for you. So the question is, how do a player maintain the same shooting action, when you're coming down to the fourth quarter? So the player is tired, fatigue, how do we maintain the consistency here? I think one of the questions is how to manipulate muscle memory. So that's the same question, right, Coach Sanjay Singh?
Yes, correct? Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Well, the first thing I would say is that a basketball player needs to be in supreme shape. If you're tired in the fourth quarter, that's a skill that has nothing to do with shooting, right? Okay. Like your cardiovascular fitness, your muscular fitness, if you're tired in the fourth quarter, how are you sleeping? How are you eating? How are you lifting? How are you training? Those are all questions where if you are fatigued, a lot of times your shooting form can fall apart. So those would be areas that have nothing to do with shooting that I would address first. And then I would look at a player's shot. That's where I talk about balance a lot of times. So these players work so much on their leg strength and their cardio fitness. And if their shot is structured to use their legs, then they won't get as tired because the legs are bigger muscles. If your shot is super arm dominant and you don't use your legs, then that's where you can see that fatigue. So if you just use your arms a lot to get the shot and you don't use your legs, your arm muscles are smaller, you can get fatigued quicker. And a lot of times, like, you see bigger post players, they bang, they use their arms get tired and then they go to shoot and they're not able to. That's where having a shot that's structured and with your legs and being able to get on balance and having that strength and being able to do that. That's why Michael Jordan was able to shoot in such big moments. Not only did they have great athleticism, but he was in elite physical condition. So he was able to elevate and use his leg strength to get a shot off. So I would say, in order to manipulate a player to be able to perform in the fourth quarter, make sure their shot is constructed to use their legs and that they're constantly working on their physical fitness so that they can access that leg power in those crucial moments.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
All right, thank you, Coach Sanjay Singh. Yeah, good question. Next up, we have a representative from INBL. If you could unmute yourself, you could ask your question. If you could introduce yourself, that'd be great. Do we have you? Yeah.
Hello, can you hear me? The issue is one of my player or two or three of my player is not able to backspin the ball, which is required during the shooting. I tried a lot of drills and everything, but still I'm not able to, you know, make them to do that. So what exactly should I have to do? Because it's like a total dead for them. No spin at all.
No spin? And is he accurate when he shoots it?
Yeah, somewhat. But as soon as it touches the ring, as there is no spin, obviously it, you know, bounce back.
I mean, how, so he's somewhat accurate. So does he make a lot of shots in competition? Or is it like he doesn't make enough?
No. I will say he is nearby, what, 50% somewhat.
He's 50% in competition?
In competition, it's 30-40.
From three-point line or from just overall everywhere?
Overall, I'll say.
Yeah, okay. So that's where you have to ask the question, because like there are different players in the league and players that I've coached that don't have a lot of backspin but are still super, super accurate. So I used to think a lot of backspin had to be a part of shooting, but I've just seen enough shooters that don't have a ton to where, you know, I don't know, some players are able to do it without a lot of backspin. But if you have a player and you're trying to increase backspin, first you want to make sure that the ball is not touching this part of the hand, it's not touching the palm. You want to make sure that it's across these pads and that his fingertips and pads and thumb are all on the ball. And that if you're sitting on the ball, you should be able to see a gap through here. Like if you're looking at it, there should be a gap and there should be space right here on this palm. And then I try to really just tell them, like, if wrist snap alone, if you're talking about the wrist, right? If wrist snap alone is not getting them to get backspin, I tell them to use their fingers. So I want you to think about your fingers firing through the zone, like as the wrist is going, really fire the fingers through, and that allows for them to get rotation and learn how to use rotation on the ball. And it's really about getting the ball in the correct position on the hand and then using the fingers. And I think it's underestimated how strong people's fingers are. Like if you snap your wrist and use your fingers, like you can shoot a ball from a long, long way.
Thank you.
That would be the first thing that I would address. Where's the ball in his hand and is he using his fingers when he follows through?
Yeah, we'll look at that.
Okay. All right. Good question.
Great question. So I know there are a lot of questions are coming in, so I'm just going to call out someone who's been raising their hand for a while. Coach Mark. Mark Salo. Can ask a question.
Okay. Hi. Thank you, Chief. Hi, Coach. My question is there any way to train or to practice how to be mentally prepared to shoot on a clutch moment, like very important sessions? Like, I know they are tired already, but is there any mental preparations or mental training, like psychologically, fitness or something like that?
Yeah, so we use a lot of, like, we call dummy defense. So we have practice players, video guys that we use to like I'll be at the elbow and the player will be in the corner, and then we'll have a dummy defender, you know, standing at the block, and I'll pass to him and the dummy defender will just run at him as fast as he can and try to just contest him, maybe hit his arm, get a hand in his face, tap his body, whatever, to try and distract him or deter him in any way. And we do different variations of that a lot. So it just kind of builds this confidence of like, okay, a player is running at me, the shot clock is winding down, you know, I can do this. And the whole element of shooting is that if you build the shot in the right way to where they're not thinking about it, then they can go and perform in those moments. But that would be as far as I would probably take it. In my experience, at least at this level, is that like there are some players who want that shot, who believe in that shot, who are confident in that shot. They want the ball in their hand. And I think what you're talking about is, you know, a fear of failure. So if you want a player to step up and be more clutch, you have to get their mind in a place to where they aren't afraid to fail, because it's a big moment. If you're going to shoot a shot with the game on the line, you know, the ball's in your hands, you make it or miss it, you win or lose the game, you know, not every player is built for those moments. Not everybody wants that.
Yeah.
And that's why that's special and that's rare when there are players that, that do want to do that. But if I were training a young player to do that, his, the first step I would do is I would work on contested shooting with guys running at him, and I would just try to address any fear of failure and just understand okay. that you shoot the shot, you make it or miss it. It doesn't determine, you know, who you are as a player or whatever, but that's a confidence issue. And I would really just try to look at, like, are they afraid to fail? Because the players that are afraid to fail, they don't want those moments.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, no problem.
Thank you, Coach Mark. And next up, we have Coach Ashwani Kumar. Looks like I'm gonna ask that question. So can we get deep into details while we are training a 6-year, 7-year olds about shooting? So that's the question Coach Ashwani Kumar wanted to ask.
Why we're training 6 or 7 year olds, or what we're training 6 and 7 year olds?
So can we get deep into details while we are training 6 and 7 year old about shooting?
Why we're training 6 and 7 year olds about shooting? Well, 6 and 7 year olds need to learn everything. So I would say why we would be teaching 6 and 7 year olds about shooting is that, like, shooting has become such a big part of the game that the earlier they get a handle on the fundamentals, the better it is going to be for their career. If they understand proper technique from a young age, they're going to be able to grow and develop in different ways. And, you know, with this, if I was coaching a 6 and 7 year old team, I'd be working on shooting, I'd be working on layups, I'd be working on dribbling, I'd be working on passing, I'd be working on jump stops. So it's not just shooting, but shooting would be a big part of it. If a 6-year old can dribble and pass to another 6-year old who can catch it and shoot it, that would be an absolute win, I would think, at that age. I personally have not coached 6 and 7 year olds. My daughter is 6 years old, so I can understand the difficulties that it may be, but I would probably say dribbling and passing would be, and layups would be the first things, and then shooting maybe after. But shooting technique is important even at a young age. If you can get them to understand proper technique, at least just the bare fundamentals, then their career is going to go on a much different path.
Great. Thanks so much. I hope Coach Ashwani Kumar, that's the answer that you were looking for. Next up, I have one of my close friends that I have here, Coach Fernando Bras, raising a hand. You can please go ahead and ask your question, my friend.
Okay. First of all, thank you so much. And I appreciate all the things that you talk to us and teach to us. My name is Fernando Bras. I'm the technical director for NBA basketball schools here in India. I'm from Europe, from Portugal. I'm here in India for 1 year, and one of the things that I was here in the past months is travel around India to see how the coaches are teaching or how the coach are preparing the sessions plans and something like that. And one of the things that I debate a lot with the coaches is the technique in young ages, like you talked before, in 6 years old, 7 years old, 8 years old, 10 years old. The coaches are teaching the properly technique of the shooting form. But the problem is the kids don't have biomechanic, they don't have space for the ball and to put the arms in the correct position. My question will be, what you think for us to teach that little kids with two-hand shot, and then when they create more space, when they grow up a little bit, we can put the shooting hand in the correct position? This is will be my first question. And the second one is, what do you think about the competition, shooting drills, competition drills on the practice in young ages? Because we know that when they are start learning the correct technique, when they go to competitions, they start to make a lot of mistakes and put the hands in the wrong place, etc., etc. So what do you think about that, and what do you think it's properly to put some competition in shooting drills in young ages? And thank you so much one more time, and nice to meet you, sir.
Yes, nice to meet you. Good questions. So with super young kids, I understand, you know, with their biomechanics at being such a young age, they won't be able to shoot like a Michael Jordan or whatever, or Dirk Nowitzki. You know, they're smaller, they have less strength. However, what I would do and what I have done with really young kids is you just bring the ball down. So I don't know if I can do it in here. So like Steph Curry, you know, shoots from here, Damian Lillard from here, Michael Jordan up here, Dirk Nowitzki back here, you know, they all shoot from different parts. So one of the key things I'd be like, can you just get their shooting arm elbow underneath their wrist? So their elbow is under their wrist and they bring it down. So they're young, they can have the ball below their face, ball's down here, and can they just get a pushing motion from here where they push and extend and they're able to lock their elbow out? It's very similar to dribbling. Dribbling is the same motion. It's dribbling, snapping your wrist, moving your fingers, passing is the same way. And then shooting is now you just bring it here and you're basically passing it to the basket. Are you able to generate power from this position and launch the ball up at a stationary target? So I would bring it and just make sure they're able to push the ball. And if you can get them to do it one-handed at a young age, that would just be a benefit. And maybe not every young kid can. Maybe they have to use like a little bit of both hands to get there. And that can be slowly adjusted over time as they gain strength and athleticism and get older. But the first thing I would do is like just make sure that their shooting elbow gets underneath their wrist as much as they can. You can bring it down here and then they can just work on this motion of like elbow locking out, wrist snapping, and pushing the ball from somewhere down here. Because if you and I were to go out from half court, you know, we wouldn't shoot it from up here. We would be down here and we would be launching it. That's basically what a young kid is doing. They're shooting how we would shoot a ball from half court or full court or whatever. They're just doing that because they're so young and the basket is so high. Does that answer your first question?
Yes, yes.
And then shooting competition, you know, I don't have the right answer for you. That's something to evaluate. I don't know how many players are in the gym. I don't know what you're trying to accomplish that day. I would say competition and having fun is a key element of the game. Are they enjoying basketball? Do they like it? Do they love it? Is it building a passion? Do they find the competition, you know, to be a lot of fun? You're like, hey, the goal with this is to just have fun. We're not evaluating technique right now. I just want them to enjoy what they're doing, to have a good time, to have a positive memory of when they think about basketball or camp or whatever it is they're doing, the practice this day. You know, you're just trying to create that positive memory so they're like, oh, I want to go to practice tomorrow. I want to come back. I have fun when I go there. If you're trying to create that, if that's the number one goal, then I would say have shooting competition and let them have fun and you're not evaluating how they're doing it. And then the next day, you're like, okay, we're not doing competition today. We're working on technique. You bring it back. You work on the technique. You have them get better. It's more dedicated practice. And you go on that type of route. And the goal every day, even at the NBA level, is not to like, okay, we're going to do exact technique and get precisely better in this exact way. Some days for us, it's like, hey, let's just have some fun. Let's play. Let's do this. Let's have a game. Let's remember that that basketball is one of the greatest games on this planet. You have a lot of fun. It takes you to a lot of different places. It's brought me here to meet all of you wonderful people. And it's not always about, you know, strict practice and getting better.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. And I wish you the best for the next season. I hope you have a lot of success. Thank you so much.
No problem. Did that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. No problem.
Thank you so much, Fernando. Thank you. Coach Ben, I'm just going to check with you. You got some more minutes on you. So I know a lot of questions are coming up. So I just want to check with your time with you. 5-10 minutes? Yeah, I'm checking.
Okay. Yeah, 5 or 10 minutes.
Okay, great. Coach Vinod Kumar, if you could unmute yourself, you could ask a question. Would you please unmute Vinod Kumar, Coach Vinod Kumar? See you on there. Coach Vinod, are you here?
Sorry. I just got unmuted. Hi, Coach. Good evening.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good. How are you? Good. Yeah, I saw some Chinese senior women team players. They used to shoot with two hands.
Thank you so much, really, so much for that. You know, deep dive knowledge about technique and getting into the shooting techniques.
Is it good to go with the younger age kids with the
Douglas? So much to, like, you know,
once they progress it, then they can go to the single hand. Like for example, I'm teaching a 9-year-old boy with a single hand form.
I really appreciate if you have any questions, please raise your hand. You can ask questions directly.
Once he master, once he come to under age of 12 or 13, then can he progress with a like single hand? Or is it good to progress with a double hand only?
I'm sorry, is double hand mean, is he using both hands to like...
Yeah, both hands, yeah. If you see the Chinese senior women's team, the point guard, I'm not getting the player name, they use a double hand release.
Okay. Well, I'll say this. So like, this is what I've talked about here in this clinic is the way that I believe shooting should be taught. Now, I will say this. The way that I believe shooting should be taught is not the only way that shooting works. Okay, it's not exact. If there's a method out there that works and it gets the ball from the ground to the player's hand up to the basket and in, then that's fine. And if the Chinese women's team has a method that works for them and they can be accurate and it helps, then great. But if you're talking about a 9-year-old boy, I would say, what is his end goal? Is it to play professionally? Is it to play in his high school? Is it to try and make it to college? Is it, you know, who is he trying to be when he grows up? How good is he trying to be? What is his passion? What is his drive? And if his goal is to try and make it professionally at some level, I would probably argue that two-handed shooting isn't the best way to do that, just because in my mind, it's more difficult to do off the dribble. It's more difficult to get organized quickly when people are guarding you and contest. You know, the defense is flying at you. So I would start with the one hand motion and I would continue on down that path based on what he's trying to do. Now, I haven't seen this two handed motion, so I can't comment on it, but I can only go based on what I know.
All right. Thank you for your thoughts.
Yeah, no problem.
All right. Thank you. Next up, I'm just going to pull up Bhuvnesh Dribble Academy. I know that's not the name, I think Coach Bhuvnesh. You can ask your question. Could you please unmute Bhuvnesh, please?
Oh, I am audible?
Yes.
Thank you, Shiv. First of all, thank you, NB and Coach, for a great knowledge. Coach, I just wanted to know about, we are working with children's kids, basically, and then we have seen the most of the difference between shooting action in girls and boys. So there's a difference between when boys are shooting the ball and there is a difference between when girls are shooting the ball. I don't know why it's happened. Do you let us know about how to bridge their gap in between their shooting action or improve their footwork drill? And or we can work a little bit of extra or in their strength on girls. Shu, please correct me if you need it.
What is the issue? So you're saying the girls shoot differently than the boys. Is
right, Coach.
Is one better or worse than and the we other? Are,
our workout is same for the girls and boys. But still, girls' shooting action is still different according to the boys.
Okay, is it different in a bad way?
Yes.
So you're saying the girls are shooting worse than their boys?
Right. And then don't have a quick release once you receive the ball and you have to be able to shoot. But girls have a little bit of slow action to receive the ball and move your shooting action to take it forward.
Yeah. So no, I'm not sure why girls would be different than boys. It could be a strength issue. But okay. Once again, I would just try to make sure that you try and get some key elements down, like get the elbow underneath the wrist and get this arm all working together towards the target. Make sure the guide hand's not in the way or moving the ball or doing anything extra. The guide hand just helps you like make a dribble and get the ball from wherever it is up to this point of shooting, and then work on their balance, their leg strength. Are their feet too close together when they go to shoot? Do they fall out of their shot in a particular direction? And it might just be that the girls aren't as strong at this point. Like maybe they need more physical fitness. And what age group are you talking about?
Coach, majorly we are working with around 6 to 7 years old children and till 16, 17 year old.
Yeah. And so, you know, I don't know. I imagine with the younger ones, it's a problem. Like, do you guys have shorter hoops and smaller basketballs that you can work with them on?
Okay.
I try to encourage when they're younger players not to shoot from too far away, because then it generates like time to just like launch the ball and throw it and all that kind of stuff. Just get them closer to the basket where they can use proper technique, and as they get stronger, they'll naturally just move further and further out.
Right. Is there any specific fitness drill for improve their shooting action or strength training?
Push-ups are great. Push-ups are really good because it generates like shoulder strength, tricep strength. So shooting a lot is shoulder muscle, tricep muscle, forearm, and then gets that wrist. You can do fingertip push-ups to strengthen your hands if the hands aren't strong enough. And then things like squats, you can just do body weight squats to get the legs stronger because you're trying to generate power from your feet up through your legs and hips, and then transfer that power out through your body, shoulder, and then release. So you should be, power transfer should be thought of from the ground up, from your feet to your quads, to your hips, all the way out, and you transfer that thrust up, and then you transfer the power out through your fingertips.
Right, right, Coach. Thank you so much.
Yeah, no problem. I hope that helped.
All right. So I know we have a ton of questions, a lot of things that we want to get to know from Coach Wen. I'm just going to ask one last question for today's session. Coach Sandeep Singh.
Hello, I'm Sandeep Singh. Am I audible, sir? Hello.
Yes, we can hear you, Sandeep. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Hello. Good evening, sir. I'm just asking, sir, that how many shots we have to take to become good shooters in just a week? Week or month?
How many?
How many shots we have to take to become good shooter?
Yeah. So this is a good question, and there are a lot of different philosophical beliefs on how many. Like, do you shoot 100 shots a day? Do you shoot 1,000 shots a day? Do you shoot 10,000 shots in a month? I don't know. Is it my real answer? I don't know the number. I would say that it is important to get technique down first. So however many it takes to get the correct technique in place. Once the correct technique is in place, because you wouldn't want someone shooting 1,000 shots the wrong way and they develop what I would call improper, you know, muscle memory. They develop a shooting path that leads them to be inconsistent over time. So once you get the technique in place, then really the sky's the limit. If you're shooting the ball in the correct way, they can shoot as many shots as they want. And that's going to be up to each player, you know, their gym access, their drive, their how much they want to be great. Are they going to wake up early? Are they going to stay up late? Are they going to, you know, be in the gym all the time? You know, how much does somebody want to get it? But if I had to give you like a rough number, I think 300 to 500 makes in a day is by far enough. You don't even have to do that many, but you know, with a young developing shooter, if they have correct technique, if you do somewhere in that 200 to 300 to 500 range based on time and equipment and access, I would say somewhere in there, about 4 or 5 times a week is plenty, way enough. I hope that answers your question.
All right. So, like, now with that question, we come to the end of today's session, virtual Coaches Clinic online session. Coach Wen, we really thank you so much for, like, you know, spending your time here and sharing your knowledge with all the coaches in India. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much once again. And all the coaches that have joined here, please look out for the other clinics that are going to come up pretty soon. We have the other clinic which is going to happen on 8th of September. Please follow our NBA India Instagram page for quick updates. Coach, I leave you any words that you want to share with our coaches here in India.
I just want to say thanks for having me. I really appreciate it. And I hope that this helps you guys as you go on and impact the youth around the world. And just remember that, you know, shooting is not, and even development in general, it's not a straight line. Like, you're going to start with players and it's not just going to be they get better and better and better and better and never have any setbacks. It's more like a stock market. Like, some days they get better and they really got it, and then they come in and for whatever reason they're a little bit worse. Maybe something's going on at school, something's going on at home, something's going on in their life, and just be more aware of like the player in general, like what is happening around them that is causing this, because it might have nothing to do with basketball. And just being aware of those things and understanding that really helps their development. And you'll see that it kind of slowly progresses over time with better and worse days. And the goal is to have more good days than bad. And if you're in tune with the players and you're creating these relationships to where they're like, hey, you know, I got a lot on my plate at school or at home or whatever's going on, then that's really going to help them connect with you if they feel like you care about them as people. And that in and of itself will help you take their games to new heights.
All right. Thank you very much, Coach. Thank you so much. Thank you very much once again, everyone, for joining us today's session. Thank you so much. You all have a good day and a good night. Thank you.
Thank you.